Yeah, first of all, yeah, this is a very interesting setup, to be honest. Speaking in this large lecture hall, and there is three people here, basically, and with this virtual setup, so it's quite unique, and I'm excited to be here. And hopefully, in the next 90 minutes, there is a few ideas or some impulses that you may get out of this talk. And yeah, I think the if there's questions coming up, I think it's the best to raise them as they come up, so then I can try to address them just in context. Usually in my experience, that's more efficient than waiting all the way up to the end. And then maybe you forgot about it, so that could be probably better in this way. Good. So, I mean, the topic you've seen, mindfulness for your leadership and personal growth. As I understood, most of are basically students. You're working towards a specific degree, and you may not necessarily think about if you hear the first time you hear leadership. What do I want to do with leadership now? Maybe you're in some engineering. A computer science program, you're thinking how to become an engineer. So the question is, why is the leadership? This is something maybe for later. And then the other thing, what about mindfulness? Why, what's going on with mindfulness? And I was trying, when I was reflecting on the topic, and you will see very soon when we get in, I usually talk about the topic of personal leadership. So leadership is not just something that you do later on. If someone gives you this role of a leader, of a manager maybe, right? I think leadership is personal. That means it's for you. And you can now already start, and every day actually, hopefully you are, demonstrate personal leadership in all your decisions that you're doing every day. And this is what it's all about, how mindfulness then really can help you on a personal level, but also professional level if you bring those things together. So let's get going. We have definitely some topics to cover. On the other hand, I'm trying to move relatively quickly through those. And usually I encourage you to, as I said earlier, ask questions to make this also a little bit more fun, interactive, and relevant, as much relevant as possible. So, who am I? Rainer, yeah, you heard my name, and maybe you checked out my LinkedIn profile prior, maybe you checked out my blog, who knows. I come from a education perspective, from a, as you heard, from a technical background in the mid-90s. I studied computer science back in Hessen, a little bit 60 kilometers north of Frankfurt, actually, to be precise. And yeah, this was the time when the internet was just came up, so it's a very exciting time. At that point, there was Linux, right, and there was Unix, so there were all those fun things to play with. I still had to learn some old programming languages like COBOL or Pascal, so some of you may have heard in some history lesson maybe about those things. But nevertheless, it was a fun time. And then when I completed my studies here, and this was in 96, 97 roughly, this was the time when I thought, where can I make the best contribution, or where can I learn to grow, continue to grow, because you need to realize that learning is a lifelong process. It's not ending when you complete your degree here. So it is really something, it's continuously going on. You will always learn. And then the question was, where can you learn, where can you actually grow the most, right? What's the best place to be? Well, for computer science at that point, for me, I figured let's go to the Bay Area, Silicon Valley. That's the place to be. That's where the action is, so to speak. And from Hesse to Silicon Valley, that wasn't that easy, to be honest, as well, right? Because think about it. How do you get from, and I grew up in some little village there in Hesse, how do you get there? How do you get to the Silicon Valley? I mean, you're not just sitting there waiting for me to show up. So the story alone, how to get there, was definitely very adventurous. It took some effort. I had to take a lot of action. I had to be persistent and really chase this idea that being in the Silicon Valley. And at that point, I remember when I arrived there first with at that point companies like Netscape, for instance. Some of you may remember or heard about it, the first browser company. That was amazing, or Apple, right? When you walked around these buildings there. And so, yeah, this was a great time. And at that point, I started my career in technology. I realized very quickly that what I learned at school wasn't, I thought it's actually quite a lot. But at the end, when you've seen the people that I was working there with, particularly at IBM Research, I quickly realized, oh my goodness, those are these, I mean, there were, I've seen applications coming in from people, they graduated from MIT, and you would look at this resume and all these extracurricular activities, publications they published, it was just amazing. And we received, I don't know, hundreds of them per day, and we would maybe invite five of them or so in a few weeks to actually present and come and interview. So it was, the caliber of talent was amazing, and I was able to really learn a lot. I continued my education, and at some point, yeah, I did, as I said, I did a lot of different things. I worked in a lot of different roles, but I, at some point, made a decision that when you're an engineer, there's usually two ways you can go once you get more and more experienced. One of them is going deeper into technical expertise. Sometimes it's called an architect. Obviously, I worked in a few of these roles. But my manager at this point, he offered me to become a tech lead. I had a small team and told me, here, there's this management thing. Try it out for a few months, like 9 months. See how you like it. And if you like it, you can continue doing it. If not, go back to what you were doing before. And that was a big change for me, because I realized if I work with others, I can actually create much more impact. It's not just myself, but it's actually through the work of others. And that's where I became a leader. And over the course of the next 15 years, I would basically work then in different roles and different capacities and different contexts and different locations with different team setups and so on, with very small teams, like 5 people, 10 people, all the way up. When I moved later over here to Berlin in 2016, at Zalando, I had organizations with about 400 people. So it was big, right? And so I really learned how to scale different levels of organizations, how to do it properly, and given all the change that's happening, keeping some form of stability. So a lot of challenges there. And the big insight for me was, it is not the the technology that is the challenge. The challenge actually is the collaboration in the organization. How do you collaborate together? How do you work as one team? That seems easy, and I think when you have seminars here and you actually work with a few of your fellow students together and try to get some project done, then you get a first glance in terms of how this collaboration thing is. It may work out well, but you may have challenges, so to speak. And if you can see very quickly that the challenges get bigger, the more teams you have, the larger the organization is, and bringing it all together. So it's at the end, it's the challenges, really, the people. That was a big realization. It's not the technology. The technology, usually, you put together a few smart people in a room, you work with them, and then there will always some solution will be emerging. But then getting it to execute and getting it done, it's that's really the this is where the leadership kicks in. And that's why I got really excited about leadership, because I, for me, I like challenges. And that's the one where I've seen is really something to go deeper in. But there is unfortunately no curriculum or something where you could here enroll, for instance, at the university and say, oh, I want to really go deep in leadership. How do you systematically become a technology leader, right? So it's not that straightforward. There is courses, there is also seminars on leadership, all kind of thing, but it's not something where you can go and then after 2 or 4 years, then you have some degree in leadership. Anyhow, so that's where I came from. And the last point I wanted to make here, and then I want to move quickly on to the other topics, was now, how does mindfulness fit into this, right? Because you heard probably now all kind of things about leadership, about technology, but what about mindfulness? And so for me, before 2015, I didn't really have a clue what mindfulness is. I may have heard maybe the term. I heard the term stress a lot because the work I was doing in this fast-paced environment in Silicon Valley, it's definitely a different speed compared to here and this in these environments here in Germany. But so I heard stress, and I was actually under a lot of stress. And this was in 2015, roughly, when I had this disruption where I was, all of a sudden, I felt the impact of stress on my body. I see what's going on. And this was, for me, completely new territory. And that was when, so I was actually close to a burnout, right? I was hardly able to work. And this was all of a sudden, so what's going on? And my employer at that point, Yahoo, they offered this MBSR, mindfulness-based stress reduction, an 8-week class, very convenient. You could go there in the afternoons. And we would basically, there was a group, maybe 8 to 10 people, and we would basically sit there. There was an instructor. She would talk a little bit what mindfulness is and then guide us into some short meditations. And I came out of these meetings very relaxed, very, very calm, and all the stress that was there before was gone. And I said, oh, wow, right? And then I started really becoming a student of mindfulness over the past 5 years, learning, meeting other teachers, connecting, workshops, videos, books, you name it. There was no curriculum, same thing. If you say that you're interested in learning mindfulness or maybe even mindful leadership, then you will have not a lot of success probably to find this kind of formal curriculum where you can go and say, here, this is very structured, I can do it. And that was for me, obviously, motivation, what I will be talking about today, figuring out, is there indeed some structured way and are there some shortcuts to it? So that's what I'm talking about. But long story short, at the end, the impact, positive impact on mindfulness, on my work, I was actually on the stress side, there was no stress anymore, stress disappeared. I was able to get back into my creative zone, into my flow zone a lot. And there was all these benefits all of a sudden. And then I figured out, wow, now how could I use this in my work context? So that was the motivation, basically. And this is what I'm talking about today. How mindfulness in the workplace can make a big difference. But I wanted to actually, workplace is one thing, so I can show you some data in a minute. But I want to actually move it back to you. And I set the topic personal leadership, and I will explain shortly what I really mean with this. How this can be relevant now to you, personal leadership, fueled by mindfulness, so that you actually will get some very concrete action items or impulses, ideas, whatever you want to call it, out of this talk, and can actually take advantage of it, or maybe not, up to you. But at least I wanted to share some of this. So, my background is scientific, so I like to look at numbers. that's important thing for me to look at data to see what's happening. And it's interesting when you look at this report here from Gallup, they show that, I mean, look at this number, 63% of the workforce are so employees. What they found out, this was a large study, are not engaged, right? Think about this number, 63%. And that, obviously, you could think about if someone is not engaged at work. So let's say you get up in the morning, let's say you're not engaged. Think about what this means in terms of the quality of your day. Let's say you come to the classes here, right, and you're not engaged. How much would you actually take home? How much would you learn if you're not engaged in your study, what you're doing? And these people are basically in their jobs, and 63% of them are not engaged. And some of them, what's even worse, are actively disengaged. So those are the actually people who can cause a lot of trouble, to be honest. If you have them in an organization or in a team, they can make things really worse. So it's pretty bad. And so what the study came out with is that at the end of the day, if you do something, if you're engaged, if you're passionate about something, if you're passionate what you're studying now, then the quality will increase of what you're doing. It's that simple. And if the quality increases, that means on the other side that customers who are interested using your services, they will get a better quality product. And that means for companies to stay competitive, they have to deliver the best quality product. So it boils down to having the best, the mostly engaged employees, right? And this share, is, I mean, 140 trillion, this is the number what they estimate. If you can position yourself into this, that you can potentially win. So there is a lot for companies, basically, a lot to win. And it boils down to the leaders, at the end, to the leaders in these companies, because a company is just a concept, right? The same as here, HPI, is just a concept, right? There's a name, there is, when you walk around here, there's a few buildings, there's this lecture hall, but at the end of the day, HPI is the combination of all the people who work here, who come here every day, right? Professors, but everyone helping to support and make this a great place. So this is really all about the people. And so it's the same thing here, that those who lead this organization, they can really shape that place. And they're at the end responsible to support it and really make it a great place to work. So that means when I was looking at mindfulness at work, I immediately realized, oh, there is these leaders, they're responsible for all of this. How can one help them to become a little bit more mindful in what they're doing, a little bit more conscious and aware, to really look at what they're doing every day and what ramification their action has. So SAP, I heard actually that Peter Bosselmann, he was actually here at some event earlier. And yeah, I know Peter, and he was actually pioneering a lot of these ideas, mindfulness in the workplace, had a lot of success there. And he was actually looking at the ROI, return of investment, right? How is this all this mindfulness stuff actually helping? And this is usually the first question I would receive, right, in meetings, and people would ask when I introduce some mindfulness techniques, what's this all about and what's the return, right? And so they actually did these studies, and they could show a really strong ROI. It boils down to the fact that if people are more happy in the workplace or if they're more fulfilled with what they're doing, there is a chance, basically, they measured in terms of the sick days, how often people call in sick, right? And they could actually see that they had a control group, and then they had they were looking at mindfulness, so a similar class. They used, I think, Search Inside Yourself, which is also a program similar to what I mentioned earlier, MBSR, a standard program that came out of Google. But They were training people with mindfulness. They would then measure after a few months and then after 6 months again. And they would show that all of a sudden sick days went down a lot, right? And they looked at other indices on how to measure this. And these indices, they call, one is called the health culture index. This makes a huge, huge impact, right? If there's 1% change, all of a sudden we're talking about 50 million euros, right? More profit. So this is substantial, right? So what came out of this at the end is that we need mindfulness, we need mindful leaders in the workplace. And that is, that was for me the motivation, because I've seen in my career when Yahoo, for instance, towards 2009, 2010 in these times, faced a lot of challenges. And I've seen what happens when companies actually go downward and when all of a sudden the leadership team also puts more and more stress onto the people who are working there. And it is this kind of downward spiral. If you work in this, the environment can become very toxic. And so for this reason, if you're in this in an environment like this, I think you have to be in there at least once to really experience this. Otherwise, you would say, oh, I don't know, right? But think about yourself when you are in stress, when you are in an environment that doesn't feel good, when you feel stressed, and when you feel that you're not at the right place, right? And you feel maybe you're also anxious, right? I think there is about certain topic, maybe that there is a test coming up, right? And you're worried that you can't pass it, right? There's all this, this causes stress, those kind of thoughts. And if you're in an environment, working environment, that is doing this, so what you need is leadership who can help and support you in this situation. That's why I call them mindful leaders, right? The leadership with mindfulness as an foundation. And when I talk here in this context soon about the personal leadership, so every time I use the term mindful leadership, apply it to your own situation, because as I said, you are a leader now. You lead yourself, right? You don't have, you may not have a team that you lead, but you lead yourself. And it is the quality of your decisions every day that you can make either conscious, fully aware of what you're actually deciding, or what's happening through otherwise, what's typically happening is 90-95% of your decisions every day actually are triggered by your subconscious. So you're unconsciously making these decisions, and 90% is a large number. That means actually for this number, 90% of your day is driven by your unconscious decisions, right? And the goal is, the motivation here in this talk is to increase with mindfulness the number of conscious decisions per day. So not just here in this here setup in the workplace, but I'm moving this all now when I say mindful leadership, personal leadership back to you, conscious decisions that you make every day. And what this means, this concept of personal leadership, is that you are in charge of yourself. And anytime you make these decisions, and as I said, you make many of them every day, they may be so little, but they actually shape your, all of your life. They may seem like completely small. Oh, what should I eat now? Or what should I drink? Where should I go now, right? These are all little, I think these are little decisions. But think about the ramifications that these decisions make, right? So I'll give you an example. Back in my own personal life, back in 93, a friend of, a good friend of mine at that point asked me if we want to go out in the evening, and basically have some fun. And he wanted to introduce me to a friend of him. And so at that point, I wasn't sure, should I go out in the evening or whatever. So I was kind of lukewarm about it. And so I had to make a decision. Do I go or do I not go? It doesn't seem like a big deal. It was just an evening, right? But at the end of the day, he introduced me now to my wife, right? So if I would not have gone to this in this evening to this place and meet her, I would not be married to her. And all the stuff that's associated with building a family, having two boys, all this stuff would never been happened. So this small decision, so think about the ramification of this little decision that when you make maybe today, tonight, a decision, or maybe you now make a decision and says, oh, what should I watch this mindfulness stuff here? And you hang off, quit the talk. But there could be an idea later coming up that triggers something in you that could change one outcome or one decision, and each of these decisions has this big of ramification. So that's why I'm really, so I think the motivation what I'm trying to hear is that if you can make these decisions, which are mostly unconscious decisions, more of them conscious, this will have a really positive impact to your career, to your quality of life, and of course also to your work, to everything, right? So this is what we're trying to do. And so mindfulness at the end of the day is really, what is this about? It's all about awareness. It's being aware, it's being present in the current moment and experience life as it is. That's all it is. So it's that simple, but on the other hand, it's that hard, because what's happening, there is a, usually I call it the voice in your head, and that voice in your head is your thinking. It's basically talking to you all the time. It may actually talk now in this moment, or maybe it's quiet because maybe I got your attention now for a few minutes, and then the voice may be shutting down, and when the voice is shutting down, you're actually experiencing what really happens, right? You can probably relate to this in a conversation if you talk with someone, and if that other person, for instance, is saying something, you could observe maybe your mind, how you're already thinking about what the response should be. You may even cut that person short and start talking, although the other person hasn't finished yet. And so this is another example where this, you're not aware, you're not in the present moment, and this is all it is what mindfulness is about. It's a very simple concept, but it's very hard to really live it, right? So I summarized a little bit what you get out of this talk. So I'll try to give you a little bit what the big picture is of mindfulness and making the claim that it is the foundation, not just for your later on for professional growth, right? That's obviously also given, but for your personal growth. And your personal growth now, as you're studying here at HPI, you will have to make a lot of decisions every day. So with becoming more aware and making more conscious decisions, you have a higher potential at the end of the day to make these decisions that feel right for you and that actually help you to grow in a very systematic, in a very deliberate way, instead of having more and more of these decisions done unconsciously or random, and you're basically drifting and drifting, not being aware what's actually happening. And all of a sudden, I know people that they were in the state that they were in their career for, I don't know, 10 years, 15 years, and all of a sudden they told me, oh, look, I think I really need to get out of this tech stuff. I've done it long enough, but I actually realized I'm more in gardening. I always wanted to do gardening, right? And all of a sudden, after 15 years, maybe in a good position, as a leader possibly, right, to decide, let's do something completely different. Because they became more connected with themselves, they got more clarity, and then they realized who they actually are is something different than they were basically doing on some autopilot, right? And that's why this topic of mindfulness is really important, to give you this clarity and this awareness. We'll go into some of the challenges, tools, methodologies. As I said, everything can be trained. That's the good news. There is no magic here. KPIs are key performance indicators. You will learn about them, or you already have, but typically in work and my environments, you want to measure things, and same for you here in personal life, you want to actually measure things that you know that there's actually some progress. So my goal at the end is then to give you, as I said earlier, a few impulses and actionable ideas. And if you only take one of them, one of these impulses that triggers something and that you get out of this talk today, then this is a good thing. And it could be shaping something that you don't even know yet, right? But looking back maybe 10 years from now, who knows, right? Good. So I want to now jump in a little bit in this mindful leadership. And every time when you hear mindful leadership, really also think about personal leadership, because that is much closer to where you are now. But it is, at the end of the day, mindful is in that term. I didn't want to call it personal mindful leadership because it's a little bit too long. And the gist at the end of the day is that mindfulness, as I said, is that being in the current moment. It's this present awareness that you actually are connected with what's happening in the current moment. It's that simple. But you also you have this foundation now with mindfulness that you're becoming, at the end, I call it the observer. You're observing, right? This awareness is attention. You're observing things. You can actually observe everything what's happening currently in your body, but also what's happening in your mind, like some thoughts that are happening now as I'm talking, but also what you speak and what you actually do. So this, at the end of the day, is a mindful leader, is a leader who applies mindfulness and uses it, but it is not an end goal. So it's not the idea that you become mindful, that, oh yeah, cool, this is this fancy thing, mindfulness, everyone is talking about it. Mindfulness is not the end goal. It's basically an enabler. It helps you to grow. It helps you in your consciousness growth, in your personal growth, in your growth as a person. It's like a catalyst. It brings out a lot of cool, helpful capabilities in you. And what are these capabilities? So, and that's why I always want to be very precise when I say there is capabilities. One of them, for instance, is this called a self-awareness and self-reflection, the ability of doing self-reflection. And that is one of the most fundamental ones that you can actually gain in this life, the self-reflection, really reflecting and going deep in yourself and figuring out what it is that, for instance, if there's a question coming up, there is a decision to make, right? That you can reflect, how does this thing feel, right? And also reflecting about your personality. And usually what's happening if the mind is very busy and you may not be able to do this kind of reflection. And in fact, you may not see certain things in your aspects of your personality because your mind is basically hiding them for you, right? So, but if you get external feedbacks from a few others, you ask a few friends, they may tell you, oh, there is this going on, didn't you know, right? So this is the self-awareness, really becoming self-aware. Clearer way of thinking is another one, right? Thinking clear. Emotional intelligence, EQ. The leader, basically, for the leader, the emotional intelligence, this is the underlying muscle, so to speak, that cultivates or provides the ability for communication, collaboration. And that's what a leader does. And if you think about it in your personal life, communication, collaboration is the center of who you are, basically. You interact with others. And sometimes you see, when you interact with others, you realize that a particular person feels like a little bit off. And sometimes you say, oh, this is not a social guy or person or whatever. And I've seen that a lot, obviously, when I was working in the computer area, right, the engineers. Some of them you would always hear, they're like hidden behind their desks and on the monitors. And they would basically program, but few of them actually had social life. They would work 16 hours a day and you would hardly see them. And if you see them, right, the communication would even, what was also not there, right? So I remember back in these days that there was always this need or urge that HR would offer then some of these, they call it communication classes, and particular engineers, for them it was helpful because it was not something some of them enjoyed. It's just the way it is, right? But the underlying, the interesting thing is that the underlying capability is emotional intelligence. And the good news is it can be trained. And it can be trained with mindfulness to facilitate this and grow this muscle of emotional intelligence. Stress resilience is also important. Stress, probably now already as you're a student, you may sometimes experience stress, I don't know. I remember I had a few stressful moments in my undergraduate time, but also later when there was the exams coming up and the professor told us basically that it's designed like this. I remember in the first three semesters, there were the math, physics, these were usually the topics, were the exams were designed so to pretty much get rid of probably 60% of the students because there were so many students in there, and they had one way to basically get rid of them is to make these exams really hard, and hard enough so that only 40% or so would pass, right? And that could obviously lead to stressful thoughts where you think about, well, will I actually make it? Or will I not make it? So you get nervous, and then when you start getting nervous, you may actually fail the exam, right? Because you're not clearly thinking, and stress is actually blocking also the creativity. So that's why stress resilience is something that you can leverage right away with mindfulness. Attention span, focus, intuition, and obviously what I said earlier, the quality of decisions. So, and these are at the end the capabilities of a mindful leader. You take leadership as you think about what is a good leader, you have probably some picture in mind, and if you think about yourself as a leader, what kind of capabilities do you want to example for you, right? And I know when you see this list here, integrity, calm, being decisive, is probably something many of you may resonate with you. That this, oh yeah, this sounds good. This could be good qualities for me. But what you can add is all kind of additional qualities, like for instance, this increased emotional intelligence, right? It will make you a better collaborator and a better communicator. Those are all good things that can happen, and resilience will increase, but also your authenticity, being who you are and not basically faking something that you are actually not, right? This authenticity, really being yourself, that is said so easy, being yourself, but actually it's very hard being yourself. There is conditioning that you experienced when you were younger, right, when you were raised. There's the society around you, there is certain behavior that people expect, so there is conditioning happening, and then being your authentic self is actually something that is not always easy to do, and so this is also something where mindfulness helps. Good, and then at the end of the day, I already motivated. If you say, well, this mindfulness thing or personal leadership thing, this sounds cool. Now, how could I actually do it, or how could I get started? Is there some structured way? And the good news is there is. So that was for me the motivation in the past 5 years, because for me this was mostly a trial and error thing. I tried a little bit here, then this didn't work, maybe a little bit worked, then I went back, right, back and forth. And so it was this kind of zigzag thing, right? And so for me, increasing or using mindfulness to, for instance, become a better leader or a better person, basically, just being more aware, right, becoming more aware, is there a more structured way to do it? And that was what I basically... what motivated me to think about it, as I'm I usually like, as a scientist again, I like structure. I like to see patterns in things, and I usually see them. And then when I was experimenting with all these different approaches and techniques and methods of mindfulness, and applying them also in the business context, I figured, oh, there is actually a structured way. And this is what I call the seven pillars of mindful leadership. I published this on my blog, I think a year or 2 years ago. It's been a while. But the idea was that if you think about these pillars, and I will go in shortly what they are, the general idea is that you can start as a computer scientist usually thinks, there is this first layer, which is the foundation, right? And then you build on methods and knowledge that you learn on this layer, you get better, and then you can move on to the next pillar, and so on. So you, it's like a pyramid, right? And this way, obviously, you don't have to do everything completely sequential, but capabilities that you actually develop through mindfulness then build on top of each other, and that obviously it's much easier to do it once you have built up some groundwork. So the example is, for instance, if you want to start, if you're a kid, right, want to start riding a bike, it makes sense maybe that you already mastered the skill of walking, right? Same thing. So first you walk, and then later you go to the bike. Same thing here. You first look at some of the fundamental pillars, and then work your way up. And with this structure in place, you could actually, if you're eager to do it, right, you could very systematically advance and start leveraging these capabilities. So the aspect is really, of all this mindfulness, is really the being part, not the doing part. When you are in a program like here in a computer science or in some other engineering or whatever program it is, we usually put a lot of emphasis on the doing. There's exercises, there is seminars, there is like your whole day is packed of action, right? And sometimes the most effective thing is no action at all, and that is called the being. The being is that you just be there, right? And one of the exercises I encourage you to try out, so I told you I'll give you some ideas, and there will be more, right? Here's one that you can try out. You create in your day, in your hectic day of doing, ahead of the day, you decide and you create what I call an open space. An open space. An open space you can put in your calendar. So let's say you try this tomorrow. This is a good example. Tomorrow you look at your calendar. You may have some appointments, whatever it is. And then you see there is a slot that is open. Maybe from 11 to 12. Who knows? And now what you do is you create an open slot. You put an entry in this calendar. That means this time is booked. That means you can't get any other appointments there, any other activities there. With the intent, you basically, you could call it open space or creative space or whatever you want to call it, but there is no agenda for this space. It's just being. So what does it mean, being? Well, you could go outside here on this campus, for instance, if you happen to be on this campus. I've seen there is the sun is shining, there is this little pond or a little mini lake here, right? There is some places where you can sit. There's trees outside. You could, for instance, just sit there for an hour. You could walk around here, or you can go walk so many nice places here in this area where you can just walk around. But it is not something where you focus on doing. You just focus on being. So you just be there, right? It could be that you sit there outside, no agenda. You just observe. You listen to what's happening around you. You see people maybe walking by. But there is no expectation that you produce anything. You just be there, right? This is what I'm calling being. Try these, I call them open spaces, creative spaces. Try to schedule one per week. And there's no objective that anything comes out of it. But see what happens. See what happens if you do them. It may be that the best, to be honest, the best ideas actually all of a sudden may come out of this open space, right? Because if the being is there and the being has a chance to get out, express yourself, you may all of a sudden come up with ideas that you had no chance of really thinking about it. You may, with these ideas or with these thoughts that could come up, if you focus on the being state, they may be very deep and profound and maybe the best thing that ever even happened, right? So the systematical part here is that you basically said, oh, there is this open space, I schedule it, no intention of whatever it is. Don't put yourself into an attention that you say, oh, I'm sitting here now, I want to have this big groundbreaking insight or idea. Then it won't work like this. So you just be there, you're quiet, you observe, and that's it. And you can do this particularly if you have busy meetings. So I used to do some of these, especially when I had these busy meetings, right? I would basically block myself an hour in the calendar. I would have no meetings. I would just be there, right? No interruptions. Sometimes I would walk, right? But no intention. But I could definitely say that a lot of the good ideas and insights came out of these things. So that was one, hopefully, thing that you can very easily try out. There's no cost associated with it. Give it a try. So what this means, you're already seeing that the state of being requires effort. And it also requires continuous training. Why is it effort? Well, it's an effort that you actually think about the voice in your head. What will the voice in your head tell you if you think about creating this open space for tomorrow, for 1 hour, or maybe 2 hours, right? But let's stick with 1 hour. The voice may tell you that this is a complete waste of time. You could maybe read a book, or you could, I don't know, watch some movie, or you could, whatever activities, doing, right? So the voice in your head may tell you all kind of things that are more important. And so it's an effort to actually silence this voice and make a conscious decision that you actually take this time and do it. Now think about this can be very hard. And if you think about this as a hard thing, as an effort, and if all of you would now decide to do this tomorrow, my guess would still be that not all of you actually make it to actually do it, right? Because the mind has enough time from today to tomorrow. Now the impulse is fresh. You say, oh, that's an easy thing. I'll do it. Sure, right? But you wake up in the morning, someone calls and tells you, oh, we should get some coffee now, right? And then the intention is gone, right? It's an effort. And if you don't have this enough of this level of awareness that you realize this, right? That you, when tomorrow morning you had decided, you put this thing, this open space in your calendar from 11 to 12, but then someone calls you, and then in that moment, if you have not enough awareness, you may not think about it anymore, or your mind will tell you, ah, yeah, that isn't it important, we can do this later, right? So the open space will disappear, and it will be replaced by busy work, by doing. And the same thing is applying, integrating mindfulness. At the end, it is training your mind. Your mind is your most profound tool that has been given to you. But the problem is only a few of us actually train it and take the effort to train it. Compare this like going to a gym, right? When you want to become fitter, let's say you want to build up some muscle, right? So you go to the gym, you train, do exercises, and so on. And you know it takes time to do it. And you may do it for a few weeks, then all of a sudden something else comes up. You've forgotten about the gym, and then maybe 6 months later you decide to pick it up again, right? The same thing happens with the mind. The mind can think about as a muscle. If you don't train the mind will actually make the decisions for you. And those decisions actually may not be in your best interest. Again, going back to this example, right? If you now make a conscious decision, I want to do and create this open space for tomorrow, 1 hour, And then, if the mind is not trained, the talk will start, and the mind at the end of the day will convince you that this open space, this idea is garbage, right? And then you have some coffee with someone. That's it, done, right? So today you had the intention to do it, but how can it be the next day that it's now no longer valid, right? It's because that it's what's lacking is this muscle of the mind is not trained. If the mind would be trained, you would not even worry about it next day, because you now know if a thought comes up in the morning where a thought tells you, oh, you could watch this movie instead, then you know, oh, this is just a thought, let it pass. So then you don't worry about it anymore, and you create your space. So it's training, and training is effort, and that's hard. It's generally hard, I know, from my own experience. And figuring out the being and the doing, how to balance them every day, this is the challenge. How much being do you want to do today versus doing? And you can do at the end of the day actually both at once. So while I'm here currently, I'm very present and focused in this moment. So I'm actually here a field, I could call it a field of awareness, being, right? I'm fully here, but I'm also doing something. I'm talking and I'm going through some of these slides here and give you some thoughts to think about. So you can balance those things, but it's a hard thing to do it. So now I'm motivated for this framework, and I wanted just to give you a sneak peek on this, that you can understand what you should get out of this here from this framework is that the mind at the end of the day, you can think about the mind, and so this is before I go into this. The mind is, I like this analogy that the brain, right? The brain is your hardware, right? So since I come from a technical background, I like to think about hardware, software, these analogies, they help me to better formulate it. The brain is the hardware. And then there is an operating system running on your brain, on the hardware, and that operating system or software, this is what I call the mind, right? So the mind is basically this operating system. And the output of the software usually has an output. The output is your ego. I call it the ego, right? Or sometimes also personality. This is what you believe you are, right? This is basically the output of the mind. The mind is a process software, outputs your personality. So from this, you can already see in this analogy that software can be upgraded. It can be replaced with software, for instance, that performs better. So you actually have the ability to upgrade your mind literally by rewriting the software. And then consciousness or awareness is what I just said. Awareness is just being aware, observing what's actually happening there, observing what's everything that happens around you. So think about yourself as a body, right, that has all these sensors, right? It starts with the skin, there is eyes, ears, there's all sensors, millions of sensors. And all of these sensors, they send impulses to the brain, to the hardware. The mind generates something out of it, maybe some picture or some situation that is the interpretation of all the sensory input. And now the consciousness, the awareness, observes what's happening, right? So I observe, for instance, here, this big room, and as I said at the beginning, there are three people in this room, it's very quiet, but if you're actually very quiet, you can listen that there is some certain noises actually in this room, right? It's maybe the air condition, so you can, once you get quiet, you can listen to this more and more, and that is the awareness. So I explained this mental model because it's helpful now to actually go into this. So these pillars, what they help you is that you can see from this complexity, very simple, these layers, understanding what happens in these layers. And if you understand what's happening in these layers, you can tackle them one by one. if you just hear mindfulness, it's a very vague term. As I said at the beginning, it's being mindful, it's being in the present moment. Yeah, okay, great. But now how does this help me, right? How do I now, what do I train, or what do I do with this thing? So the way to look at these layers that helps you then for each of these pillars, I categorized different dimensions. Like, for instance, each of these pillars has specific challenges and goals to it, right? There is certain resources and knowledge that apply to these pillars that you can systematically learn. There is methods that you can use or tools to train this particular pillar, right? And then in each of these pillars, you may be able to find experts, right? There could be an expert, or not just one, there could be many experts that you can actually get help from, who can help you to make progress in these pillars. And when I say progress, you can actually measure progress in each of these pillars. I mentioned the word KPI, right? Performance indicators. Each of these pillars has a few of these KPIs available, and you can create obviously more. This is just a few suggestions. But you can see this is where I am, then I do something, right? And then at the end, I'm here, right? So you can see how you progress in these pillars. So this is where you really, where you can really, for each of these pillars, have these different dimensions. And that can be very helpful then to organize and split the complexity. So here they are, right? 7 pillars. I go through them very quickly so that you can get a gist of what they are. The pillar number 1 is the underlying foundation, consciousness growth. Consciousness is really the awareness. In the mental model I described, the observer, you as consciousness, observing what's happening in your body, but also outside of your body, and how you think, how your mindset is. And growing this consciousness basically means that you become more and more aware, so that you become more and more immersed with life, with everything that's happening around you. This is pillar 1. Pillar 2 then is about upgrading the software, what I just said, and a very particular example, I'll talk later, but there's a lot of bugs in your software. There's a lot of routines and ideas stuck in this software that are not necessarily helpful for your day-to-day life. So let's basically clean this up and upgrade it. And then number 3 is all about conscious decisions. Most of us will react, as I said at the beginning, 90-95% of your daily decisions are done by your subconscious, completely automatically. There is no time, literally, no time to think, because the subconscious mind is much faster in the processing time than your conscious mind can do. That means at the end of the day, if you don't have the chance to put in little breaks in this thought process with the help of awareness, you have no chance of reacting differently. You want to react more and more consciously, right? I'll give you an example. If you, let's say you go out in the evening, you meet a few friends, maybe you sit in some bistro, restaurant, whatever it is, you have a small discussion, all good. And then some of your friends says something to you, and all of a sudden, in this very moment, you feel some anger coming up, right? You get really angry, you feel it, it happens. And all of a sudden, you jump out of your seat and you do something, right? Maybe, I don't know, maybe you leave the room, or maybe you do even something aggressive. I have no idea. I'm just saying this happens, this anger comes up, and you're completely, without conscious decision, you're completely lost in this. You basically just react on autopilot. And then maybe 15 minutes later, you calm down, and all of a sudden the awareness is back, and then you say, what the heck did I just do? This is not me, right? But you couldn't do others because you're aware, you're basically, your mind is not trained in this situation to do it differently. That's why I'm going back to training the mind. So making conscious decision, feeling this anger when it comes up, arising in your body, and then all of a sudden put in a little break, little thought, little empty space, and it can be a fraction of a second that you have this little empty space in it. And then you let this anger pass, it's still there, the anger is there, that's fine. But now you think about, instead of maybe bursting out or doing something stupid, how do I actually react consciously? Now you have this little time was all that's needed to make a different decision. But that's one of the hardest ones. So pillar two and three, they're very hard. They require this training. Pillar four is about cultivating forgotten qualities. I call them in quotes, like I mentioned at the beginning, emotional intelligence. There are things in there like gratitude, kindness, forgiveness, right? All those things that help you to do empathy, right? Compassion, that could be very helpful in with your surrounding, with people you interact every day. But cultivating means you have to cultivate them with consciousness, with mindfulness, but you have to train it. And a very simple question I ask you, think about as a kid, how many years did it take for you to learn reading, right? So you may have started reading as a process in kindergarten, maybe later, but think about how many hours in school you actually practice reading, right? Could be many years, right? And add up all these hours. And then if I ask you a question, how many hours in the past 20 years did you practice gratitude? How many hours did you practice compassion? And so what? So maybe there's 1 hour, maybe there's 10 hours, I don't know, right? But if you compare these two, then you can understand why you are better with reading than, for instance, with empathy, right? It's just the training, the number of training and the focus you put in there. And that leads me to pillar number five, connecting with yourself. And this is one of the, this is now where you can start to reap the benefits. Pillars 1 to 4 apply pretty much to every human. It's basically upgrading the software on your mind, upgrading your mind, the operating system of your mind, cultivating consciousness growth. But now with a growing consciousness, what's happening is you have more clarity, your ability of self-reflection that I mentioned at the beginning is increasing. And now you can actually look at your own situation, your own life, in quotes, and you can ask the question, why am I here? So ask yourself this question, why am I here? What I'm doing here, what is this, right? And why am I taking this class now, or why I'm enrolled in this particular program, or why I'm doing this sport, or whatever it is, you can question pretty much anything and think about what is it that I'm doing, right? Why am I here, right? This is a very fundamental question. And you can answer this question only then if you have enough clarity, that means enough awareness. If you don't do the training of your mind, the answers that may come out when you ask yourself these questions on your purpose, the purpose is the why, right? Why am I here? Or what is the inner motivation that, for instance, I'm attending this lecture here now or this talk? Why am I attending this talk, right? Think about it. Or why am I planning to join basically here back school next semester? This is the inner motivation. It's the purpose, the why question, right? There is a vision. The vision is think about yourself 5, 10 years from now, right? And there is one exercise you can do. I encourage you to do so. The next exercise for you tomorrow morning. When you wake up, try to remember this, right? And maybe write it down in a little note in your smartphone or whatever. Set yourself a reminder. The first thing you do after you wake up, you're still in bed, right? You wake up. And then do a journey. Imagine yourself 10 years from now, right? Keep your eyes closed and then imagine yourself 10 years from now in a very particular day. And then just see visualize, see what's happening, see how you see yourself. How would your day look like in 10 years, 10, 20, 30? How would it look like? What do you see? What do you feel? What do you smell, right? Imagine this day, and suppose this is a perfect day. Suppose it, basically think about the perfect day in 10 years and see what you, and do it in the very early morning. The reason to do it in the very early morning is that the software is not fully up and running yet. So the mind is at this point still not fully processing, right? It's still in this little, more in this, I call it awareness phase. You're fully aware usually in the first few minutes, but the mind, the operating system will take over very quickly. So if you do this exercise fast enough, you have actually a chance to outsmart your mind, so to speak, and you can see things with awareness. And if you see this day, this is basically what I call a vision, something in the future, what you want for yourself or you feel you are connected to. And this can be anything, right? And then the mission is the way to get you there. It's the tactical steps, short-term steps. It could be that you're visiting now this particular class, or that you're taking a certain set of classes in the next semester when it starts. So these are tactical short-term steps, your mission, that get you closer towards this, because you figured you actually need this degree, whatever you're doing now, that gives you like an entrance ticket into this next thing, and then you can achieve this and this. So it's this kind of systematic planning is at the end of the day the mission. And some of those things, of course, you can't plan everything, right? But it is, that's why I said that the mission is a journey, and you can give it some shape, some structure, and some planning. But the idea is it brings you closer to your vision. And you do it by connecting with yourself, and at the end of the day, living also your values. How you do it is more important than the goal. This is, I call them your essential values, right? What's important to you, how you want to do it. It's the journey that matters, it's not the goal, right? The goal is just like a star, it gives you direction, but more important is always the current moment is what's important. Nothing else, right? The future is just something that is basically in your mind, right? It's some idea. Again, these are just thoughts where you think about the mind, or if you think about the past, but you always think about these things in the current moment. So that's why the current moment at the end is the most important thing, how you do things, right? The values, how you do it. And this is all part of the clarity on what it is, and I usually recommend when you're at this level, really write it down. I like a one-pager, can be a document, it can be notes here in the smartphone. Write it down, write down what is my purpose. And a good purpose can usually be summarized in one or two sentences. It doesn't have to be more. But to come up with them, that's a little bit more process. That's why I said, right? Think about your vision. So try this exercise. I encourage you to do this exercise tomorrow morning. First thing when you wake up, envision a day 10 years from now, or 5 years, whatever you want, and think about, really go into this experience of feeling this day, observing it, and what would be like a perfect day look like in 5 years, right? And then once you've done this, get out of bed, write it down, right? A few sentences of what you just thought about, write it down. And then think about, in terms of a mission, right? How do I get there, right? So let's say you see yourself, I don't know, in some small, so a typical stereotype thing, you see yourself sitting on some small island with some ocean around it, and maybe there is a, you're running some bed and breakfast there, so I'm just making this up, right? And this is what your ideal day looks like. Maybe you still have the smell of this coffee that you would drink in the morning with you, right? Then you have to think about, how do I get there, right? And then maybe if I do this, this, and this, is this the right thing to get there, right? And there is no right or wrong, right? It's just something can help you to get faster or slower, right? Anyhow, pillar 6 and 7 is more for leadership at work. So I don't want to go into this, since this is, you can pretty much see that on pillars 1 to 5, you could pretty much put all kind of things on top, and that's just fine. So the methodology I mentioned, science-based approach to mindful leadership, there's a lot of material on my blog that you can read, themindfulleader.net. There's all kind of different things that at the end of the day in these different pillars, you want to measure it. If you can't measure it, then how do you know what it is? How can you improve it? That's the key message here, right? Measure things. So I want to go quickly through some of these, not all of them. The important part is in pillar 1, just that you see this level of consciousness, present awareness. This is the goal. And consciousness is really pure. Consciousness is the awareness, the observer of all your experiences. And if this is one thing that you get out of this whole talk here, is the separation between awareness, between the mind and the brain. This idea that you bring these three things, you separate them, this thing alone will trigger something in your own mind, actually, because you will ask, why is it necessary to separate them, right? But there are benefits. You will notice these benefits relatively quickly, because if there's two things, right? On one side, you have the observer and the mind in a certain distance. That means this distance helps you to look at things at a certain distance. So you're less getting basically mixed into all of this mess, right? So let's say you're in a problematic state, right? And there is no distance between awareness and the mind. Everything is mixed up. Then a problem can really look bad. It can really look terrible, right? Oh my goodness, the situation I'm in is so bad. And then you come one side after the other. You go into this feedback loop. And then, because there is no distance to it, you believe all this stuff. You believe all your thoughts. And the reality is actually most of those thoughts are not true if you start inquiry. That's what you would do in pillar 2, in doing inquiry of your thoughts, for instance, right? But if you keep a little bit of distance between the observer and what's actually happening, you'll see that these problems are actually not that bad, right? They look, maybe there are challenges, but they're not that bad. So I want to do very quick for 1 minute, a quick exercise with you that you can do casually at home or wherever you sit, because I talked a lot about consciousness and concepts, right? But I actually encourage you now for a minute, and you can do all this now, to basically close your eyes, relax a little bit, focus on your breath. Just feel the breath, how it goes into your nose, and experience how this feels, right? And tap a little bit, feel a little bit into your body, feel what's happening there. Is it tense? Is it maybe tired? You may need a nap, but feel into your body, how is it feeling? And also feel, Where is this? Who is observing this consciousness? Where is it sitting? Do you feel it in somewhere in your head? But where is it? Is it a little bit more in the back? Where do you feel this awareness, this field of awareness? Where is it, right? And now tap a little bit into sounds. Listen what's happening around you. And you may notice some noises that you have not noticed before. Maybe also, is there some smell, something that you observe, something that you can smell, right? And then, with this set, go back to your breath. And when you're ready, open your eyes again and come back to the current situation. And this was experiencing yourself as consciousness, as pure awareness, right? And this exercise, you've seen, it's so easy. It's at the end a very simple 1 minute mini meditation or check-in or whatever you want to call it. But what it really is experiencing yourself as consciousness, as the observer. And when you practice this with these little minute exercises like this, so I encourage you as another takeaway, practice this little exercise for 1 minute. Every time you feel a little bit stressed maybe, or every time you see your mind is like wandering or is basically overthinking and is in this high energy mode and you say, oh, let's slow down a little bit. If you do this exercise for maybe 2 minutes and just feel into yourself and you notice afterwards that usually it creates this little break so that afterwards you feel, actually even with a minute, you feel refreshed, to be honest. But this is consciousness. There's no magic. That's it. It's basically experience, right? It's awareness. So there is no magic to this. And growing it, the challenges, this will be the challenges that you will see, is your, call it busy monkey mind, identification with thoughts, and your mind trapped, in quotes, in the ego, that there is not this distance, what I just mentioned, is not there. But there is a good news. There is formal meditation practice that you can try. Like, start with 5 minute meditation. I'm sure when Peter was here, talked about from SAP and talked about mindfulness, he mentioned that meditation is available. And I'm sure some of you have already tried meditation, and there is also no right or wrong way to meditate. It's just being there, like in this exercise. But if you do it, let's say 5 minutes per day, and then you feel, actually you'll notice something. You will see some effects. And then to give you a sense about KPIs, what KPIs are, right? KPIs is very popular here, is thoughts per minute. This is something which is a very cool one. You can try this out with your smartphone, where you set a timer. You do this exercise, what I just told you, put a stop a clock for, let's say, a minute or two. Usually I recommend actually doing 3 minutes. And then you set yourself the intention of not thinking about anything. So you force yourself, oh, I don't want to think about anything. And you stop the timer, 3 minutes. And then maybe you have a checklist or some pen, right? And then you close your eyes, you relax. And then every time, although you had said you don't want to think anything, but if there is a thought coming, you notice there is some thought, you basically check it, right? You count it. Then you count basically these thoughts, and if you get entangled in these thoughts, you bring back your focus back to the breath, and you remind yourself, oh, I want to count those things. And then you continue. So it's fine, perfectly fine, just count. And then when you have this, divide this number by 3, then you have the average thought per minute. You do this in the morning. I encourage you to do it in the afternoon, after lunch, and do one in the evening. This gives you average number of thoughts per day, right? And that is an interesting number. And if you actually, if you're starting to do this a little scientifically, right? If you do this, let's say, over a month, and let's say you would actually take this idea that I said, and oh, let's do this 5 minute meditation thing. There is smartphone apps, whatever, that can help with this at the beginning. And you do this, and then notice actually with this number what's happening. Is this number changing? Is it going up? Is it going down? The other thing, you would be surprised, whatever number comes back, and I don't want to give you an expectation, but the only thing I can tell you, I did this exercise a long time ago, and I was amazed about the number, right? Because I had set myself the intention, there's no thoughts, right? And then what number came out was interesting. Anyhow, so with that said, consciousness growth at the end is a journey. There is different levels of consciousness that you can actually experience. But I think it's all about your personal transformation. And I observed some of these different phases here, so they can be helpful in your personal growth. And also what's happening if you do those things, that your mindset is shifting. That means, what does this mean? For instance, in this idea of when you actually use this KPI thoughts per minute, lots of thinking to almost no thinking. So you will actually notice when your consciousness is growing that the number of thoughts is going down. So that's, for me, this was a very motivational thing when I've seen my number in terms of thoughts per minute. I said, what the heck? I mean, this is using so much energy. Every time you think, the brain is using so much energy every day to do all these thoughts. If you actually increase this number of thoughts, right, the mind becomes calmer, it uses less energy. And this is part of things what's going to happen. So there's a few other of these pillars. We don't have time to go through them. I wanted to, for me, the key thing was to show you that there is a framework, there are these different pillars. And where I want to go actually here, I'll go very fast through them, because what I wanted to show you is actually still if you take action items in the last 5 minutes. The summary here is that mindfulness really is the driver for your consciousness growth. So that's the motivation why you should actually care about mindfulness. It will increase your present awareness, which is the moment, always the current moment. And it allows you, with this increased awareness, actually allows you to reprogram your mind. So it becomes more in a way that it's helpful for you, not the other way around, right? And with this clarity, there will also be a lot of helpful qualities getting out of this, pillar four. But then you will use this increased self-reflection, self-awareness capability to really also get clarity for this question, why am I here? What's my purpose? What are my values? What is my mission, right? And that is really in this stage where you are in now, when you're basically attending some program, right, and you're thinking about a career. Don't think about a career, but think about what is my mission, right? And to answer this question, what is my mission, you need this clarity. That's why I encourage you to go use this framework and experiment with it. All this detail is on my website, and you can check it out and see what happens if you do it, right? There's not much to lose. But this is an important point I wanted to make. There is no such thing as a free lunch. We always said this in the Silicon Valley. But then Google came at some point and there was a free lunch. But my point here is that consciousness growth at the end is something, it requires a strong commitment of time and resources. And you will see tomorrow when I gave you this exercise to create this open space for 1 hour. Reflect on the evening tomorrow. Maybe put yourself a note down now that you can see tomorrow evening, because you may otherwise even forget about this, right? But then see whether you actually had this 1 hour empty space, right? Where you had no task to do anything, where you just to be there for 1 hour being idle, right? Maybe even the mind could in this time become bored, but you're not setting any expectation. And then see what happens if you actually did it. If you did not do it, you can see my point here, that unless the mind is really trained, right, and you have this awareness, it's actually very hard to do it. And if tomorrow evening you actually didn't take the time out, you forgot about it, or something else came up that you felt was more important, you'll probably understand better why I made this point. It's nothing bad, right? There is no pressure or anything. It's completely up to you what you do, but it shows you with these simple things, basically, how difficult and how hard they are. That's why without this commitment and training, it's really hard to get ahead. So a few action items, what I wanted to get you, also practical things, I already told you two or three earlier that you can try also with, for instance, this creating this open space. If you have not done meditation, try to get curious about it and maybe take 5 minutes, maybe download a meditation app. See, experiment. Just being there for 5 minutes in the early morning or in the evening could be a cool thing. sprinkle in mindful exercises, like when you brush your teeth, that's my favorite one. Feel actually when you brush every teeth, become fully mindful and put all the attention of brushing the teeth. Mindful eating, mindful showering, whatever you can do. Leverage technology. There are three things I put in here. Muse meditation, Oura ring, heart math. Google them. You'll find devices that can be helpful for your consciousness growth. And if you're a scientist, you will enjoy these all these numbers coming out of these devices. But they actually help you to do, for instance, meditation a little bit more with scientific feedback. And that may be something that could be useful. As I said earlier, think about a powerful mission, what you want to accomplish in life, not a career. Don't think about the sequential thing that I start as a programmer, then I become a senior programmer, or whatever it is. No, think about a mission. Think about what you can accomplish in this world and how you get there. Start balancing life categories. That's a very important one. I know when I was a student, I was pretty much doing too much learning already, right? I should have probably done even more partying, for instance, right? This is all balance, right? Balance the body, the mind, spiritual relationships, quality, and all those things. At the end, there is always more than just one thing, so the art is in balancing of everything. Optimize your health, even now. My recommendation, even in this age, I was amazed to see what kind of things you can do if you find a good integrative doctor who can help you. For instance, the brain, right? Brain performance. Like, this is amazing what you can do over time. When the mind becomes trained, it also needs a really healthy body. That's an important part. People often forget about this. Mindfulness, but then they see that the body is not working, right? Okay, Fellowship of Mindful Leaders, if someone is interesting, could be good for your personal growth, you can check it out. And last not least, there's a few relevant books and resources. I will make these slides available so you can download them and go through your leisure if you want to. And I also offer some technology mindful leadership mentoring program if you're interested in this. I only have a few slots for this because it's free for college students. It's for me a way to give back basically from my experience and things that I learned over time. This could be helpful, but again, I only have a few slots for this that I can do. But if you're interested, something that could be interesting. Good, and I think with that said, I think we're already 1 minute, I think, over time, if this clock is correct. So, I don't know, is there questions or anything that came out?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Eine Sekunde, wir haben auf jeden we've got some questions here in the Zoom chat. Assuming one is already a mindful person, how hard is it to become a good leader?
Yeah, I think it is just a process of doing, right? It's practicing. Leadership is not something you read in books, it's something you do. And if you have mindfulness already as a foundation, that's great. It will help you to become a better leader, but it still takes time, right? It takes years, and with every year, you get better.
Thank you. It seems that maybe the Tilta screen is already offline. Is that true? No? Also. Okay, one further question. No, not here. No more questions from the audience. Maybe good. Here. Good. Then maybe I've got a last question before we all leave. I really like the thought of mindfulness, and I attended two courses, and I always thought, wow, this is great, and I want to perform it, and I think it's easy for me if I'm not stressed. In times of where there's not so much to do, then it's working out, but as soon as I come into a stressful phase, it's very hard for me to stick with mindful practices and like meditation and stuff like this. How can I use it when I need it most?
That's a very good observation. Actually, this is actually the standard. So you're not alone in this. I think all of us, at some point, when there's more and more stresses coming up, we automatically, with the subconscious, right, with the awareness, gets pulled away from the action is taking over, and then it makes it very hard at this point to actually keep being aware, staying present in this moment. And then the mind will tell us that now meditation is not important. This is something you do later when you have more time. So you will then do even more stuff, and you do more stuff. That means you will actually get into more stress, right? And it's this feedback that happens. So when you need meditation the most in the stressful times, this is actually the best time to meditate. So the trick is basically to bring in a little bit awareness when this happens. So when you realize, you feel, let's say you realize there is a lot of stress currently, and then the mind will tell you that there is no time to meditate, even 5 minutes, then the trick is to basically don't believe the mind, right? The mind is just telling you something, it's not worth doing it now, but especially then, this makes a huge difference. And you've seen the technology before, I use devices, for instance, to measure stress, like this thing here, for instance, here is measuring stress levels in real time. And you've seen when you're in a very busy day, when you look at your smartphone and you see the graph and the stress levels are high, there's all this action, and 10 minutes of meditation, or even less, right, you do it, you see that all of a sudden the stress goes completely, like, it's like you're sleeping, basically. It's like at night, it's like completely low. And this happens within a minute. But it only happens within a minute because I have trained it over years, right? So I can do it in 30 seconds, even if I'm sitting in an S-Bahn or wherever, I can shut the mind down. And then there is this relaxation happening for your body, where this gives you then a lot. After these 10 minutes of meditation, you come out, and all of a sudden it's like a recharge of your battery. Right? So when you need it most, don't skip it. Try to outsmart your mind by saying, oh yeah, this is just a thought that I shouldn't do it now. And find the time, but not find the time, you make the time by saying, oh, there is a slot here, maybe in the morning or maybe in the afternoon, even at work. I mean, at Zalando, for instance, we had even meditation rooms, right? So there's always a way where you could carve out these 5 minutes, right? And it makes a difference, because afterwards you will be much more productive, you will be more calm, right? And you can over time this becomes a habit, right? But if you don't do it, you get more and more stress, the quality will go down for whatever you're doing. So it's actually a good thing to start breaking this habit.
Yeah, thank you a lot. Yes, one last question, or it's maybe two questions, 1 second. Thank you for the presentation. In the context of work, how is it possible to think about mission without thinking about career, especially for young researchers and engineers? And also, do you have any specific meditation app indication?
Mm-hmm. So maybe I'll start with the easier question. The easier question, like, is meditation application? There's lots of them. And I mean, nowadays, if you search for meditation apps on iPhone or Google Play, right, there is really good ones. So I actually use and it's a link in the slides, the Muse Meditation, Muse, M-U-S-E, meditation headband, which is a device that measures the brain waves in real time while you're meditating. And it has obviously a lot of guided meditations that you can use. Particularly for the beginner, it's a really great tool because it actually gives you an answer. Did I meditate now in the right way? Did I actually do some progress? Was it a good meditation? It actually tells you these things, how you actually proceeded. There is 7Mind, company startup here in Berlin. They have a great app, 7Mind, right? There's Headspace, there's a few others. Again, there's no right or wrong. The idea there is that this app will help you a little bit, particularly at the beginning. It gives you some guidance. It has a timer. So it's a great way to get into a practice. Later, you don't need it anymore. And then the other question was about a mission versus career, right? And I think this is now actually now the best time to think about this, right? When I was this age and was at school, I didn't even have this idea that there is something like a mission, right? For me, this was like a thing, oh, you study, and then you basically start working as a professional in this field, right? And then whatever, you work in a company, then they have a framework on how, like a ladder that you can climb, right? This is the typical way you think about this. There's nothing wrong with it, right? But later I discovered what's happening after, let's say you work for 10 years, and then let's say you reach the top of this ladder. What do you do then, right? What's the next step, right? And then you realize that this idea of a ladder, this is all garbage. This is mental concepts where that you believed are to be true, right? That there is a need to climb this ladder. There is no need to climb anything, right? So it is more helpful, that came later in the reflection, thinking about, what is my vision? And you can have this vision, you can refine this vision, obviously, over time. But this exercise I gave you, wake up tomorrow morning, and while the mind is still in this shutdown phase, and the awareness is there, and think about this day in 10 years from now. How does it look like? And this gives you ideas in terms of what a mission can be. A mission can obviously be that, for instance, to do this, let's say you want to become the best biologist, or you want to become the best engineer in a particular, very specific field. This is all valid, right? But if you think about it, not in terms of a career, but in terms of a mission, you can make completely different choices, right? You may, for instance, decide after 2 years, you're getting out of this large company because you say, I have enough learned in a large context, I want to go now to a startup. So you break a career path, but you're still gaining more and more experience by jumping into different field of experiences that you would otherwise not have, because you would stick climbing this ladder, right? Only to realize at the end of the day, once you reach the top, what am I doing here, right? So think about a mission. A mission is something powerful, and a mission can be, the more harder it is or the more inspiring it is, the more others will actually follow you. There's people out there in the world, they have big visions, right? Like Elon Musk, for instance, colonized the Mars. That's a mission, right? It doesn't mean that you have to have the same mission like this, colonize the Mars, but maybe you want to build the first base on the moon. I don't know, right? Just making this up. But it can be, the mission can be powerful. It can be something that you're passionate about, which is aligned with your purpose. And then how you get there, if you spend a few years here, a few years here, whatever it is basically your path. It's the journey, right? And that's why it's helpful to look at it in terms of a mission, because the mission remains, right? Colonizing the Mars remains. Even if you work in this company or in this company, it's not a career. It's basically you stay on this mission. And if other people ask you, basically, what are you doing, you can talk about your mission. And then you see eyes going up. They understand this. If the mission is good, they understand what the mission is, and they may even want to join you in this mission, right? So that's why it's good now to think about it, but you need a certain clarity. So I would say get the meditation app and meditate a little bit more, right, and get a little bit into practice. And over time, when the mind gets quiet, use these spots in the early morning when the mind is still in this downward, in this mode where it's not fully active. Try to reflect then about your vision and also about your mission. And this is typically what comes out then can be much more powerful and something not what your ego wants you to do, right, your personality, but what comes from a deeper perspective from yourself.
Thank you. I think those are great last words for our presentation today. So thank you, Rainer. Thank you, everybody, for questions in the Zoom call, and also for participating. And thank you for being our guest today.
Thanks. Yeah, I really enjoyed it.